What about privacy issues with an interpreter? Is it, pardon me, could the patient have some privacy issues by bringing an interpreter into the mix of the conversation?
Sure, and that's why it's important to say up front that when it's your hospital interpreter that they understand the confidentiality of the content of the information. But there's also cultural issues where, you know, in some cultures it would be inappropriate for a male to be discussing certain information mm-hmm. with a female. So you want to make sure that the interpreter is culturally appropriate for the conversation that you're having.
Okay. Have you ever had a situation where the patient brings their own interpreter?
Well, they might bring family members in who they're used to using in doctor's offices or in other situations to interpret for them, but that really isn't a good idea in a medical situation. There are a lot of complicating factors. One is they might not know the medical terms. They have a relationship with the patient, so they might filter some of the conversation. They might change the meaning of some things to protect the patient. It might not be appropriate for them to hear certain information about someone else. Mm-hmm. So it's really best not to use a family member as an interpreter. If they want the family member there when the conversation is being had, that's their choice. But it really is best to use someone who's not invested in either side of the conversation, who's really just there to say the same words. And that reminds me, there's another factor where when you're using an interpreter, expect that everything you say is going to be interpreted for the patient. So if you make any snide comments or observations or whatever, the patient is going to hear that too. And also, that would be assuming the patient knows no English. If you wouldn't do it with an English-speaking patient, you shouldn't do it with an interpreter.
I would agree with that. That makes total sense, yeah. Let me ask you this. Would you have any tips for a hospital on how to select an interpreter or perhaps how to select a company that may provide that service?
I know we have partnered with colleges and universities in the area who have language departments who can help guide us mm-hmm. with how to do this and what's available. That might be the easiest way to go about it. Or ask other facilities and organizations nearby and find out what they do and how they do it. Again, because my hospital will help other hospitals train their certified interpreters, then maybe there are others that do that too.
Okay. Do you ever get into situations where the street dialect may be different than the formal dialect, where the interpreter may not know a word or phraseology?
Yes. And our class actually addresses that, you know, so because it's not even street dialect. Sometimes, for example, in Arizona, we have Spanish speakers. Is our primary non-English language, but they come from all over the world. And the language in Argentina is very different from the language in Mexico, mm-hmm. from Spain, from Guatemala. So we really need to have our people trained in the different versions of the language mm-hmm. So that they're familiar with what's going on. And that's why teachback is so important when you're using an interpreter also, to make sure everything is clear.
Sure. I can see the advantage of having the interpreter with education. And both you and I know that education is supposed to start when there's admission to the hospital, and it should continue on until discharge and beyond. But if you're paying a service to do it, how do you handle normal communication if there's just a medication or something that's got to be done? Do you call the interpreter every time? Are there best practices for that?
You really should. I mean, there's also the fact of when you have an English-speaking patient, you have casual conversation when you just walk in to check the IV or the vital signs or something. And those are opportunities for conversation. Mm-hmm. So you really should have the opportunity to talk to your non-English-speaking patients just as regularly. It might help to lump them if you're going to be using an interpreter or a phone service. You really need to make those opportunities available every day and not wait for the patient education moments that are planned.
Yeah. Is there some risk of liability if you're not able to do that?
Well, there's certainly, I know our interpreters have to document that they were involved in the conversation. Mm-hmm. So I'm sure if there's a problem later on, you will have to demonstrate that you made some effort to communicate clearly and to evaluate understanding. Informed consent, all these things are involved.
Yeah. Two things that we actually didn't talk about when we were discussing this prior to the recording. What about handouts if you don't have anything in their native language? What are the options for the educator?
Well, if it's a language that is written, and that if the learner can write, then certainly asking them to take notes is a perfect way to do it. If not, then recording the conversation is another way they can review it later on.
Okay. The last question I have for you, what about our friends at Joint Commission? Do you know what their position is or what their expectation is regarding different languages?
I haven't reviewed their guidelines recently, but I know they're very clear that it is essential that you communicate clearly with patients who don't speak English as well as the people who do. Mm-hmm. So I don't think they give you specific rules about what to do or how to do it, but I know they want to make sure that you have done it and that you have some evidence that they did understand what was going on, that it was informed consent, and that they did know how to take care of themselves when they got home.
Okay, so just like with all things education related, document, and document that you educated the patient, documented specifically what you discussed and what the patient acknowledged, as opposed to, are you ready to go home? Yes.
Get me
exactly.
out of here.
Yeah. Okay. Well, this has really been an interesting conversation, because there's a lot of things that you mentioned that I would not have thought of. So this is very enlightening. And I appreciate your time today. Why don't you tell folks how they can reach you online?
Well, I've got a blog at www.notimetoteach.com, and I'm on Twitter at NoTimeToTeach.
Okay, and I appreciate you doing some of the retweets on some of the things that we do. It's nice to see those. Thanks very much.
Thank you for tweeting them in the first place.
Yeah, we really need to get a few more people involved with us in talking about this stuff, because, you know, I don't know about you, but I don't find as many blogs and things talking about patient education that I would like to see. So maybe there'll be some more people out there that'll get involved and carry the flag.
That'd be great.
Yeah. Well, I wanted to let folks know that they can get your book at Amazon and other booksellers. It's still in print. And as a matter of fact, we ordered some the other day, and the publisher said they were back ordered, said it would be mid-February, but they showed up Friday. So I was real pleased to see that. And they can also get the electronic versions of your book. And then also for those that want to do training classes or group sessions with your book, they can get discounts on quantity purchases from your publisher at Pritchett & Hull, and their website is p-h.com. So folks that want to buy, you know, 30 or 40 copies of the book to pass out to staff can do that and save some money. And it is a significant savings, I think 30-40% over normal retail, so it's a pretty good bargain. And for folks that may be interested in doing some additional training by adding video into their process, can contact us for video on demand and other video-related solutions by visiting our website at synergybroadcast.com. We have a a video on demand system we call MMDS, or Medical Media Delivery System. So, Fran, thanks very much for spending time with us today, and I look forward to talking with you next time on another topic.
Okay, thanks,
Chuck.
Okay,
bye-bye.